So one, two, one, two. I hope you can hear me, and if you're online, you can see me. So members of the college, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's my real great pleasure to welcome you to tonight's festivities and to the inaugural lecture of Professor Jenny Quint. In particular, on behalf of the college, I'd very much like to welcome the family and friends of Jenny and to say thank you to you for your support and also for putting up with Jenny when she's not at work. How you do that, I'm not sure. So my name is Edwin Chilvers. I'm head of one of the departments in the Faculty of Medicine, the National Heart and Lung Institute, and I have the pleasure of introducing Jenny's lecture. Following this, there will be an opportunity for questions, both online and in the room. And that will be hosted by Professor Deborah Ashby, and then there'll be a vote of thanks at the end prior to the reception from Professor Vidicha. So I'm asked to tell you that in the event of a fire alarm, you are to leave via the marked routes, exit the building, turn right, and we should congregate at an assemble point just by Exhibition Road, where I'm fully anticipating that Jenny will continue with her lecture and without aplomb. So what does it take to become a full professor at Imperial College? Well, it takes a lot, and I suspect that Jenny, while she'll take us through very ably her medical and scientific journey, may be somewhat reluctant to tell us about some of her many real fine standout achievements. So that's my job. As I hope you may have read, Jenny is our new Professor of Respiratory Epidemiology. Actually, you're a year old, so you're not that new. And we'll sit with a foot in two of our departments, my own department and that of Deborah's in the School of Public Health. Both of those sit in the Imperial College. In addition to her academic role, where she runs a very large research group that's based on our new White City in Hammersmith campus, she's been pulling in the research grants and now personally responsible for over £10 million worth of research grant income. She's also a clinician and holds an honorary consultant physician both at Imperial and at the Royal Brompton. She's the fellow of three very distinguished bodies, the Higher Education Academy, the Royal College of Physicians, and the Faculty of Clinical Informatics. Jenny is also the analysis lead for the National Asthma and COPD Audit Programme and is Deputy Director of BREVE, which is the UK's biggest respiratory data hub. She's about to take over, if that's not enough, as the editor-in-chief for Thorax, one of the world's leading respiratory journals, and holds a senior position within our own professional body, the British Thoracic Society. Jenny is also a dedicated and inspiring teacher, leading on research skills and cardiorespiratory training within our undergraduate medical school. So I've nearly finished, but I'm going to finish with a warning. And just to say this, that inaugurals are tense events. There's always an air of frisson, and I have no intention of dispelling any of that nervous anxiety. We have an expectant audience, an argument of academics. Apparently that's the collective term for us. Your family sitting nervously on the front row. So Jenny, the room awaits, staff and students, experts and non-experts, members of the public just intrigued by your abstract, and those, in truth, who are just here for the reception. So you have to please us all. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Jenny Quint.
Thank you very much, Edwin. I hope I don't disappoint. So when I turned four, I had my birthday party at Mally's Ice Cream Parlour on Lorraine Road. And so the story goes, I proceeded to tell every single child who was present as I opened their presents what I didn't like about them, why I thought they should be returned, and even in some cases telling them that I didn't remember having invited them in the first place. I would like to think that I have mellowed with age, but only a few months ago, Professor Chilvers asked me if I was capable of doing subtle. So perhaps I haven't. And so some of you might be a little bit nervous now as to exactly what's going to come out this evening, because what you see is what you get, and I tend to say it exactly like it is. Nonetheless, this has clearly haunted me. I've had a few recurring dreams of talking to an empty room, so much so that I thought about renting a crowd. This is a thing. I had no idea you could do it, but you can. The problem came with trying to decide what kind of crowd I wanted to hire, and then I realised that this was too difficult a decision to make. So my first thank you of the night is to all of you for turning up. So thank you that I'm not in an empty room, and also to all of you online who signed in. I can think of many things I would rather be doing on a Wednesday evening than listening to me drone on for 35 minutes. This has arguably been one of the most difficult lectures that I've ever had to write, and that's because some of you in the room are interested in this particular causal pathway, trying to understand how that turned into that, perhaps with a few mediating factors along the way. I will embarrass you, Lucy Parsons. That's the role of one's mother. Others of you, though, are here tonight because you're more interested in understanding as a research group over the last 10, 15 years, how we've taken what's in one end of a GP record system, turned it into a piece of meaningful research, and perhaps dealt with various confounders or biases along the way. But before I start any teaching, lecture, I need to know who my audience is. So we're going to start with a Mentimeter quiz. So phones out. So this gives you poetic license to be able to check your emails while I'm talking for the rest of the evening. And I want to know whether or not you think routine healthcare data should be used for research. Yes, if you take a photo of the QR code, then you should get a little yellow bar that comes up at the bottom that allows you to click directly to Mentimeter and you can vote. So Alex is kindly collating the results for me here. This is. You need to vote, Visha. Yeah, no, I'll give you a moment. Don't worry. Don't worry. I factored in time for vote. There is Wi-Fi. No, there should be Imperial guest Wi-Fi. You should be able to log on.
Yes. Okay.
Ready?
Submit. I've done it.
Okay. Right. Now, Visha's voted. Yeah. Okay. So go for it.
Okay, we have 92% agree and 8%. I have no idea.
Have no idea what I'm talking about. Okay. Well, I know one member who's in that 8% who have no idea what I'm talking about, but not sure who the rest of you are. So the standard definition then of routine NHS data is anything that's collected in an automated fashion. So essentially it's everything that happens when you seek healthcare, be that primary care, secondary care, you attend your GP, they code things within the medical records, they write things within the medical notes, and then a number of us use these type of data in order to answer specific research questions, potentially inform policy. So primary care, secondary care, when you go to hospital, attend A&E, get admitted to hospital, there's often things that happen within hospital. So if you think about being on an intensive care unit, having blood pressure measured all the time, or having blood tests done, all of these things get recorded in a way that we can then use them onward for research purposes. If we think more specifically of the COVID-19 pandemic, then things such as COVID testing and surveillance. And there are also more specific disease registries or audit programs that take place, again, where collection of data occurs. So a phenomenally rich source of data that can potentially be used for informing policy as well as for research purposes. When I teach the medical students, I often start with a brainstorming exercise around what do we use data for, and these are the lists of some of the things that they managed to come up with. But the list is enormous and ranges all the way from where should NHS England give money, where do people need it the most, how do we plan for resources, right the way through to how do we monitor performance, where is quality good, where is quality less good, all the way through to being able to understand what the size of certain disease populations are so that we can target in terms of treatment. But if you'd have said to my 8-year-old self that I would be standing here tonight talking about data, I would never have believed a word of it, because I was always going to be an astronaut. I grew up in the age of watching spacecraft take off on television and in the era of Space Camp. That was my favourite film growing up. And it wasn't until after we'd moved to the UK and I was in school here and my physics teacher turned to me one day completely blasé and said, "You do realise that your physics isn't good enough to be an astronaut." And I remember thinking, well, I get all A's, I'm in the top set, so I really don't understand how my physics isn't good enough, but okay, who else goes into space? Doctors go into space. I know, I'll do medicine instead of being an astronaut. That's how my thinking worked. And it wasn't until years later, when I had 5 offers from medical school, 4 London universities and an offer from Cambridge, and I failed to get the grades that I needed at A-level, that I appreciated that maybe it wasn't just me that had a problem with physics, and that perhaps there were other issues within the school and the teaching, which meant that I wasn't capable of being able to pursue my dream. But failing is great, and I would encourage everybody to do it. And there's 2 main reasons for that. One is it gives you phenomenal clarity on what it is you really want and how important something is to you. And sometimes failing means that you change direction and you do something else instead. And other times it just helps you to be able to focus and realize that you really want to achieve something. The other reason that failing is absolutely brilliant is because there is no way to get any lower. You're at the bottom. And so the only way you can go is up. And so I would strongly encourage all of you, if you haven't done it yet, to make sure that you fail at something, because it really does feel good. So I went on then to restart my A-levels, even did an S-level in chemistry, went on to the Royal Free to read medicine. Then in my 2nd year of medical, started going out with my now husband, and suddenly going to space seemed like less of an appeal. I ended up doing a medical SHO rotation through London, through Barts and the London, and decided at that point that I really wanted to be a cardiologist. And in those days, in order to end up in a particular specialty, you tended to do an extra 6-month job after you'd done your rotation. So I came to the Brompton, I did 3 months of ITU, 3 months of cardiology, and day 1 of cardiology, thought, oh my God, I do not want to work with these people for the rest of my life. I'm really sorry to all the cardiologists that I work with now, but it did not go down well. So I panicked, and I thought, well, I've always wanted to be a cardiologist. What on earth am I going to do now? So I looked in the BMJ, as you did in those days, for jobs being advertised, and they were advertising a London respiratory training number. And so I thought, well, I don't really think I want to do respiratory medicine, but I don't know what else I'm going to do, so I'll just give it a go and see what happens. There was 1 training number, and I was lucky enough to get that. But it really does make me feel for the medical students today who have to show all this commitment to specialty from birth, because, quite frankly, if I'd have had to do that, I wouldn't be anywhere near here today. So I started my respiratory SHO rotation, and then when it came to deciding that I wanted to do a little bit of research, I'd loved my intercalated BSc, which I'd done as part of my medical degree. I really had a bit of a sliding doors moment. So I don't know, Visha, if you remember this or not, but you and Gavin were on the central line on your way to the London Chest. I was on my way to a training day at the London Chest, and I happened to get in the same tube carriage. And Visha and Gavin were talking about FEV1 decline and all of these things to do with COPD, and I was standing there nearby, and at one point Visha noticed me. And we started chatting. I'd worked for her before as an SHO. And she said, I'm just putting in an NIH grant. I'm looking for a clinical fellow. Would you be interested in being the clinical fellow who's named on the grant? And I thought, well, absolutely, that would be amazing. And that genuinely is how my PhD came to pass. So I spent a fantastic 3.5 years with Visha, undertaking my PhD, looking at determinants of exacerbation frequency in COPD. So this was a lab-based project, and what I realized very quickly was that I was never as good at the lab science as the scientists were, and that whilst I loved research, this was arguably not going to be a long-term career for me in the lab. During that time, and how Visha put up with me, I don't know, but within a 4-month time period, I got married, had my daughter, and moved house, and still managed to complete my PhD. I went back into clinical training, and then actually in another true to form week, I had a week of 7 nights on the intensive care unit, and within that week had my PhD viva and my MRC postdoc interview for my population health scientist fellowship. So my second tip for the night is, if you're going to go for something, just go for it. Have a really awful short period of time and then just get it out of the way, because it works wonders. So I had the most fantastic 5 years or so at London School, and I'm really humbled that people are here tonight and online listening from London School. I had the reputation there for being the Imelda Marcus, always known for my shoes and my handbags, and I hope I've not disappointed this evening. One of the things that I learned very quickly, though, was that whilst I never had any difficulty getting papers published because they were underpowered statistically, what I hadn't really appreciated was how complex using data were, and that it really is garbage in and garbage out if you don't know what you're doing. And there is so much bad electronic healthcare record work that goes on. And if there's one legacy I would love to have, it's around really improving the way in which we use these records and getting them used more, because I don't think we use them as much as we should. So I'm going to show you a little video now. So this is part of a video which I showed to the medical students. And an enormous shout out to Emily Cook, who's in the audience tonight, who's a researcher from Australia, whose sister happens to work with me in my research group, which is how I got put in touch with her. She makes videos for her teaching, and very kindly, with no funding at all, helped me to put together a Lego video for the medical students. So hopefully this will explain to you why we're having this lecture, and I do need to thank Lucy Parsons for playing the role of Bob.
Today, I'm going to tell you the story about Bob. Bob was walking down the road one day when he accidentally fell into a hole. He got taken by ambulance to hospital, where he was seen in the A&E department and told that he'd broken his leg. Bob had to have surgery on his broken leg, and after the operation, Miss Singh wrote the operation note to go into the medical records. After some time, Bob made a good enough recovery to be able to go home from hospital. Although Dr. Alfonso had been the junior doctor who clerked Bob in, because Bob had been in hospital for a while, Dr. Alfonso was now on his day off, and Dr. Clare was the FY1 who was asked to do the discharge summary. Dr. Clare struggled to read Dr. Alfonso's handwriting and the operation note, and missed off the fact that Bob was supposed to attend his GP for referral for more physio. Bob was in a lot of pain, so rang his GP. Dr. Jones didn't even know Bob was broken his leg, as the discharge summary hadn't arrived. And when it did arrive, it was put on the scanning pile and set to one side to be scanned into the medical notes later that week. And it was due to be scanned into the notes, not formally coded, because discharge summaries simply get added to the record as a scan. Bob was eventually able to have his physiotherapy. And went on to make a full recovery.
So hopefully that gives you some idea as to the importance of these data, what gets entered into the data, how we use them, and how we communicate across the healthcare service, and why this work that we do is so important. I should also thank Lucy Parsons for spending a good 5 hours with her mother one Friday evening while we took and retook the voiceover of the short clips of video, because it took me a while to get it right. So if you want to find somebody who has a diagnosis of COPD within medical records, this is essentially what you're faced with. So there are over 54 codes to indicate that somebody has a diagnosis of COPD. The ones on the left-hand side are very specific codes that we validated many, many years ago by sending out questionnaires to GPs. And the ones on the right-hand side of the screen are part of the quality and outcomes framework, so codes that GPs get paid for in terms of use in certain activities associated with particular diseases, but they are not disease-specific. They're there really as a, if I think somebody's at risk and I'm concerned that they might have an underlying disease, then I would use these codes. However, what happens a lot of the time within routine practice is because the QoF codes are easy to get hold of, people use QoF codes, and I'm going to show you a number of examples tonight about the dangers of just picking up off-the-shelf things like this that haven't been thought about and validated when there isn't understanding about how and why people code in a particular way. So when I first moved to London School, Kieran Rothney, who's here tonight, who I still work very, very closely with, was my first PhD student. And one of the pieces of work that he did was around trying to understand how people code exacerbations of COPD. So people with COPD sometimes have acute deteriorations where they become more breathless, sometimes requiring treatment from their GP, sometimes requiring hospital admission. And we wanted to better understand how these events get coded using various different algorithms within the electronic healthcare record data. So we sent out questionnaires to a number of GP practices through the Clinical Practice Research Data Link and got them to tell us whether or not certain events that we'd picked out by these algorithms in the background were or weren't, in their eyes as the treating clinicians, exacerbations of COPD. And I've just put the summary slide up here, but essentially you can see that there are a couple of different groupings of definitions which give you different positive predictive value and different sensitivity. So basically to varying degrees of accuracy are able to tell you that something is or isn't an exacerbation. And I will show you a little bit later on why this is so important. But at that particular point in time, Kieran then was able to take these definitions that we knew were valid and worked and be able to start to look at interesting things within clinical records. So this is just one example from a piece of his work where we were looking at time to death relative to the number of exacerbations that you have in a baseline period, and essentially showing that if you have a severe exacerbation or the more increase in numbers of moderate exacerbations that you have, the increase your risk of death. And Morgan was then my second PhD student, who's also actually followed me here from London School. She's on holiday this week, and happy birthday, Anne. But her PhD was particularly looking at cardiovascular disease outcomes amongst people with COPD. And here we took a number of different cardiovascular outcomes compared with the general population and found that it didn't really matter which one we were looking at. You had an increase risk of these outcomes and of mortality if you had underlying COPD. So essentially COPD increasing your risk of cardiovascular outcomes as well as increasing your risk of mortality. Kieran and Anne and Liz moved, Kieran and Anne moved with me then from London School over here to Imperial, and we were for the first 5-6 years based solely within the NHLI here at Imperial. The team grew and we started to expand a little bit more into the things that we were looking at. So this is some work that Philip Stone did as part of his PhD, where as part of my role as the analysis lead for the National Asthma and COPD Audit Programme, we were trying to better understand if these pay-for-performance metrics were actually useful in terms of improving patient outcomes. So I mentioned to you before that the quality and outcomes framework in primary care doesn't really lead to improved outcomes, doesn't necessarily show you the right people who have your underlying disease of interest. So he was particularly looking in hospitals at what we call the best practice tariff, which is awarded in terms of payment if you're able to reach certain metrics on discharge. And essentially what we established is that, you know, what people get really good at is ticking boxes. And so you can show that you're doing certain things, but that doesn't actually translate into improved quality and care for patients. And that's something that we're really starting to think about as we move forward, is how with all of these audit programs and all of these other tick box metrics and benchmarking that goes on, can we ensure that this actually gets translated into better clinical care? Alethea Gale in my group did a PhD around mortality, focusing on COPD, but her first piece of work was looking at mortality across a host of respiratory diseases. So we've got four different respiratory diseases here: asthma top left, bronchiectasis top right, COPD bottom left, and interstitial lung disease bottom right. And we're looking at mortality over time in people with those specific diseases relative to the general population. And you can see that actually the mortality for people with respiratory disease in the UK is really significantly higher than that of the general population. So what we've started to do as time goes on is try and delve into this a little bit more and appreciate what are the underlying causes of death. And this particular slide is breaking it down by disease chapter, so ICD-10 coding, so quite high level, but trying to understand what is it that people are dying of and where can we potentially intervene or do things differently to be able to improve mortality for our patients with chronic respiratory disease. Eleanor Axon, then, when she was with me, she's now moved to work at CPRD, specifically looked at the association across heart failure and COPD. And in this particular piece of work was looking at the use of managing heart failure, so actually making a diagnosis and treating heart failure relative to your risk of having exacerbations of COPD. And what we found is that if you were known to have a diagnosis of heart failure and were treated appropriately, that your exacerbation risk was less than if you actually had suspected heart failure but weren't being appropriately treated. So again, potentially providing an opportunity where we can intervene and manage our patients with COPD and heart failure better to be able to lead to better outcomes. Hannah Whittaker then in my group did her PhD looking at lung function decline in people with COPD, and in this particular piece of work was looking at risk of cardiovascular endpoints among fast and slow decliners of COPD, as well as those with frequent exacerbations and predominantly breathless. those who were increasing risk of breathlessness with the MRC score. So what we found was that there was no particular change or difference in cardiovascular risk. If you looked at the accelerated FEV1 decline and the non-accelerated decline, but there was an association that was associated with an increasing number of exacerbations and also increasing amounts of breathlessness. And I think one of the fundamental problems that we have within respiratory medicine is that there is no biomarker or gold standard for an exacerbation of COPD. And when these patients often have multiple other comorbidities and symptoms overlap, I think there's a lot of misdiagnosis, which then translates into misclassification in the medical records, and this is why you see significant problems in this patient group. Claudia Guglia then looked at things the other way. She used a lot of US data as part of her PhD, looked specifically amongst heart failure populations and tried to better understand what was going on with COPD, looking at it from a heart failure standpoint. And in this particular piece of work, she was trying to better understand clusters of comorbidities that we saw within heart failure patients. We expected that there would be a COPD cluster amongst a heart failure population that would have worse outcomes, but actually it wasn't what we found. And then Varun Sundaram, who's a cardiologist from the US, did a split PhD with me and back at Case in Cleveland. And he was particularly interested in understanding peripheral arterial disease, as well as coronary artery disease, and picked up this particular piece of work, which Kieran had started when he was with me, looking at troponin levels after a heart attack in people with and without COPD. So when you have a heart attack and you get admitted to hospital, a specific blood test called troponin gets elevated. And what we found is that if you have COPD, your troponin level does not elevate as much as it does in somebody without COPD. And the reason this is really important is that when you go into hospital with an exacerbation of COPD, your troponin level is often slightly elevated. And what we do 90% of the time is we ignore it. And so what we're trying to do now at the moment is do some work to better understand if we actually intervened on these slight elevations in troponin, could we do something to reduce major cardiovascular events later on in the COPD patient population? So everything was running really smoothly, and then COVID hit. I know that Professor Chilvers was particularly concerned over COVID, that work ethic may have altered a little bit in people in their home environments. So I just want to reassure you that we were closely guarded and heavily watched at home, and that there was significant meowing if it was felt that we had not stayed in one place for long enough to achieve the work that we needed to achieve. I tried very hard to delegate. I tried note-taking, I tried touch typing, neither of which worked particularly well. However, meeting delegation was beautiful. And I would highly recommend that if you do need to delegate meetings, I will rent out Tiger Lily, who will meow a lot at you afterwards, although you may not understand exactly what went on during the meeting. But as with everything in life, there's always one who doesn't conform, and Maleficent was never anywhere to be found to be particularly helpful. On a serious note, though, COVID did a lot of good things for data and for research. So it really brought data to the fore. And where everybody had always thought about data as being the poor cousin of randomized controlled trials, what people started to realize is that actually data could offer an awful lot in terms of answering research questions and doing it quickly. A lot of the red tape and the bureaucracy disappeared. My first postdoc fellowship, it took me 5 years to get permission to be able to link two data sets together. Technically wasn't difficult, but it was just all the red tape of who owns what and controls what and will allow what to happen. And all of that went. And if there's one thing that I really hope remains, it's this ability to be able to do things safely and quickly and at scale. The downside is that everybody thinks that they're a respiratory epidemiologist now, and it's not always easy to operationalize these data. I was really privileged over COVID to be able to work with a large number of collaborators across the country. I made a decision very early on that I wasn't going to try and get any glory out of this. I wasn't looking to lead something myself. A lot of people, I will say this, tried to increase their careers off the back of being able to do things in COVID. And I said, no, I'm going to sit back and I will help people if they ask for my help. And that was absolutely the right decision because I ended up on over 40 publications in a one-year time period just over the COVID pandemic. So this was a lovely piece of work that was led by London School, where we were just trying to understand how underlying conditions and the prevalence or the commonality of these underlying conditions might impact the risk of COVID. And then Anna Schultz and Ian Douglas went on to do a beautiful piece of work where we were trying to better understand amongst people with respiratory disease whether or not certain treatments were protective or potentially made things worse with their underlying COVID. There'd been a lot of sort of discussion in the beginning around whether or not maybe taking inhaled corticosteroids might be protective in some way. And so a lot of uncertainty in this particular patient population. So Anna did a really beautiful job with this piece of work. A little bit later on then, under the Breathe HDR UK hub that Edwin mentioned earlier, we were very privileged to work with the team at the Office for National Statistics and to do some work for JCVI, the Joint Committee on Vaccines and Immunisations, and help to determine, particularly amongst people with asthma, whether or not they were at increased risk. There'd been a number of conflicting papers that had come out. I won't go into poor methodological design, but there are reasons sometimes why things are different and why you find certain things. But in this particular piece of work, we waited until we could use the second wave of COVID data because of the selection bias associated with using the first wave of data with who was tested, and essentially found that unless you have severe disease, and as long as your disease is controlled, so if you have well-controlled disease and it's relatively mild, then you're not at any increased risk relative to the general population. It's all the other risk factors that are really driving the increased risk that you see in COVID. And then probably my favourite bit of work that we did over COVID, so I turned to the research group in January of 2021 and I said, all right, we're kind of over the first bit of this, who fancies doing a bit of work? And this was just fantastic Team Quint work, and I am so proud of this and the team for what they pulled off here. So we cut a set of data in February of 2021 and had submitted it to the BMJ by Easter of that year. It was really an amazing collaboration. I'm going to tell a Lucy story now, because I was particularly proud by this piece of work, and I said to Lucy when it finally got published December time, I'm quite pleased, particularly as this was just me, my research group, not a massive collaboration with 1,000 people on it. We just kind of did it, got on with it, and it's informative. And she turned to me and she said, Mother, let me look at that. So I showed her my phone with the paper on it. She says, first of all, the title makes absolutely no sense. And I thought, well, okay, actually, you've kind of got a point. The title could have been a little bit clearer. She then says, wait a minute, I know all these people. This is your research group. I said, yes, this is my group. She said, well, they should all be really proud. She said, they're all in their 20s and they're getting a BMJ paper. She said, you're nearing 50 and you're only just now getting a BMJ paper. You shouldn't be proud, you should be embarrassed. At which point I just gave up and I thought, I'm just not even going to try to pretend that I have a brain cell. But essentially what we were trying to understand with this work was whether or not people managed with COVID-19 in the community. And what was unique about this study was actually the community population that we looked at, because all the studies to date had been done in hospital, whether their outcomes in terms of longer term consequences differed to those admitted to hospital and those relative to having had a flu. Right, phone's out again. We're going to do another little quiz. So the other tradition that we had over COVID, apart from working on the BMJ paper, was introduced by Alex, who's another PhD student who's been in my group, where we looked at pictures that he would bring us on a Friday morning for our team meeting, and we'd have to guess the film. So I would like you to put in a guess as to what film you think Alex was depicting with these jelly babies and the box. And if you're all really struggling, I'm just going to say count them. Is anybody daring to respond, Alex?
There's a lot of responses.
Okay. Are any of them right?
Very few.
Would you like another clue?
Yes, I think we need some clues.
Okay, so I'll give you another clue. It's a Disney film. Okay.
They're still popping up.
They're still popping up. Okay. We'll give it another minute.
Shall I?
Okay. Yeah, go for it.
Okay, so there are a lot of quite interesting suggestions, including human centipede, clockwork orange, and snakes on a plane. The correct answer was Snow White, which most people got.
Okay, so yeah, so Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, and I hadn't even appreciated this until we were putting these slides together, when Alex pointed out that he'd actually cut the legs off the jelly beans on the side to make them dwarf size. But for those of you that didn't get that one, I've got one more for you before we keep going, so have a go at this one. Okay, how are we going with this one?
This one is people have found a lot easier, I think.
Have they?
So again, some interesting ones like Squid Games, but the correct answer that most people got was King Kong.
Brilliant, well done. So you can all join my research group on a Friday morning. We carry on doing these live now. So I'd love to be able to say that, sort of having come back now post-pandemic, as things sort of, well, kind of post-pandemic, as things sort of start to ramp up again into more general research, that some of the things that I showed you in the beginning are better now. But actually, coding remains an absolute nightmare. And this is a piece of work that was led by Claire McCrae and Hannah Whitaker, where we were looking at simply systematically reviewing the literature to better understand what codes and how many codes there are, looking across different respiratory diseases. And you can see that if you just look at one type of coding system, so what we would call read codes, the CTV2 codes, there are nearly 250 different ways in which you can suggest that somebody has a diagnosis of asthma. So things not really getting better, and if anything, becoming more and more complicated. As I've mentioned already, I've had the pleasure of co-leading the Breathe HDR UK hub with Aziz Sheikh up in Edinburgh. And one of the things that we've tried very, very hard to do is to harmonise and standardise some of the codes and the algorithms that potentially get used across respiratory data sets. And we've worked very closely with the team in Swansea at SAIL to be able to put these on their portal so that people can use them then for their own research purposes. It also then means that once we've been able to do that, we can start to look at curating specific sets of data. So this is work that's being led across the Breathe Consortium. So Sarah Hattam up in Edinburgh, Sarah Cook and my group, Sean and Chris from SAIL, where we're using SAIL data and CPRD data. We're taking common definitions across the two, and we're creating almost bespoke respiratory off-the-shelf data sets that people can then pick up and use for research purposes. And whether they use our data sets or they use the algorithms and the coding that underpins that, it then helps people to do this in a much higher quality, faster way. And we're looking to do this now with NHS Digital and their trusted research environment. I've alluded a few times now about some of the importance of coding, and I think this slide and the next slide are probably my favourite slides ever, and I'm probably going to keep using them for the rest of my career. So this is work that's currently being done by Hannah Whitaker and Kieran Rothney, which has been sponsored by GSK. We've looked in the literature at what people use for definitions of exacerbations of COPD, and all of these five definitions here are published in terms of what people have used to determine an exacerbation of COPD. If we take those five definitions and we take a simple analysis, so this is looking at the risk of exacerbation in people who do and don't have heart failure, you can see that depending upon which definition you use, sometimes you see that there is an association that's positive, suggesting an increase in risk, And sometimes you see an association that goes completely the other way, suggesting that there is less risk. And this, to me, is just incredibly concerning. And I think is why we really need to work together as a whole to better understand and to use these data to high quality. And the same way that clinical trials get registered and there are standards that need to be met, I think we need to get much, much better at the standards that we use across using routine electronic healthcare record data. Because otherwise, you risk people doing these studies and essentially being able to show what they want to be able to show by using different definitions. And in fact, when I first presented this slide at a meeting, somebody came up to me afterwards and said, oh, isn't that interesting, because all of those definitions are correct. And I nearly leapt off my seat and I said, no, this is the whole point. They're not all correct. And this is what we've got to try and stop. We've done this across a number of different areas. This is work that Alex Adamson is working on at the moment, looking at the quality of coding of pneumonia. There's a lot of interest around inhaled corticosteroids and people with COPD and whether or not they are at increased risk of pneumonia. And we've gone on and we've delved into really trying to understand how you code and validate pneumonia within electronic healthcare records, because a lot of the codes overlap between exacerbations of COPD and pneumonia. And again, there's lots of things I will be able to show you going forward which suggest that definitions really, really matter. And I could do the same thing with examples across asthma. More recently, I've started working with Gisli Jenkins and his team, and in particular Pete George, who's here tonight, who's helping to co-supervise a PhD student, Rakisha Shah, who's unfortunately not here, she's in the US. And Anne Morgan is also helping to supervise. And we're trying to understand how people code for interstitial lung disease. So feeling like we've got a really good handle on COPD and asthma and bronchiectasis, trying to understand a little bit more with interstitial lung disease. And we start this by doing relatively simple things, like just understanding the frequency with which codes are used. But the other thing that's really important to understand is how coding changes over time. And one of my, again, favorite examples in teaching that I use for a paper that I use years ago looked at COPD and said that there were missed opportunities for diagnosing COPD within electronic healthcare records. But what they didn't take into account is that back in the 1980s, we didn't have a code that had COPD. We called it COAD, or chronic bronchitis or emphysema. And here with the IPF codes, you can see that there is a definite change, which actually is associated with new guidance, clinical guidance, as to what and how people are coding interstitial lung disease within electronic healthcare records. And if you don't understand these subtleties, then you miss really important things within the data. Similarly, it's really, really important to understand when you need to use linked data, so primary care data on its own and primary care data linked with hospital data. Again, I could have shown you examples across COPD or asthma, but this is just looking at interstitial lung disease and understanding the overlap between what goes on in primary and secondary care. And then building on from this, Georgie Mathen, who's co-supervised with Ian Stewart, who's also here tonight, again funded by Gisli's work, trying to better understand across fibrotic diseases how we might code for these things. So we're very much moving much more into multimorbidity and understanding other diseases a lot of the time, because respiratory diseases aren't just restricted to the respiratory system. And this is where it's been absolutely fantastic to have been able to move jointly and work across with the School of Public Health as well as NHLI. But when you understand what you're doing and you know what you're doing is accurate, then you can actually do some really useful things in terms of informing policy. So this is just straightforward looking at the incidence of asthma in a childhood population and how that's changed over time. And you might look at this and think, oh, that's really good, asthma's going down. But if you then look at exacerbation rates in that same cohort of people, you see that it's not going down. So the people who are getting a diagnosis are sick, they're needing healthcare, and it's suggesting that we're making the right diagnosis in the right people, but isn't telling us that there's a problem with asthma that's going away. There's certainly something there that we still need to be thinking about. And similarly, we've done work in an adult population. This is work from a pediatric population, where we've then looked at referral from primary care and into secondary care to try and better understand, are the right people with asthma who are poorly controlled in primary care being seen and managed by the right people within secondary care? I alluded earlier to the fact that the quality and outcomes framework with COPD isn't as accurate as it could be. This is work that Phil Stone's working on at the moment that's been funded by Asthma and Lung, where we're simply looking at the prevalence of COPD, how that's changed over time, and how that varies with a number of different definitions. And you can see that actually if you just look at hospital records, The blues haven't really come out very well, but that's the bottom line. You underestimate. If you use the quality and outcomes framework, again, you underestimate. But if you use the validated COPD codes, then you get a much more accurate picture. And if you're using this to try and work out how much funding does a particular area need for pulmonary rehabilitation services, for example, then you need to be able to better understand what's my underlying patient population. And again, we're working very closely with asthma and lungs. So Anne Ioannidis in my group is looking at patient pathways, trying to better understand how long does it take for somebody to get a diagnosis of their underlying respiratory disease? Where are they getting that? How is this working? Again, so that we can start to find these people earlier and treat them more appropriately. Shubin Zhang in my group is a qualitative researcher. She's been doing a lot of qualitative work because patients are fundamentally at the center of everything that we do, and trying to better understand communication and experience that people have around the way things are communicated with them when we're explaining risk and we're making their diagnoses. So you'll be pleased to know that the wine's not far off now, and I'm on to my thank yous. I want to thank my research group, who I think are truly amazing, and I would not be standing here tonight without you. I was ready to resign about 18 months ago, as a number of you know, and thank you for pulling me through this. A huge thank you to Edwin Chilvers and Deborah Ashby for supporting our move so that we're jointly placed across NH Lyons School of Public Health. I'm loving the opportunity to collaborate more. A huge thank you to my parents for always being so supportive and encouraging, and again, a number of times picking me up off the floor when I was ready to quit. Thank you for pushing me through this, because I am really, really pleased to be able to be here tonight. An enormous thank you to my siblings. You're very welcome for this photo. who have taught me that you should never take yourself too seriously in life. And thank you all very, very much for being here. I know some of you have travelled quite a lot and moved around your plans for this evening, and I really, really do appreciate your being here. And last but not least, to Tony and Lucy for keeping me sane, for keeping me grounded. It's impossible to get a big head in our household. And I'm going to end with just another Lucy quote. So I found out that I'd been promoted to professor in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic. So it was July of 2020. Edwin rang me to tell me that my promotion had been successful. And I turned to Lucy and I said, God, isn't this amazing? I'm a professor. And she looked up from what she was doing and she said, Mother. You always know it's going to be bad when it starts with mother. She said, I really don't see what you're so excited about, because at the end of the day, it makes absolutely no difference. You are still you. So thank you all very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Jenny. So I'm Deborah Ashby. I'm the director of the School of Public Health that Jenny has joined, and she's been working with us for a long time, but actually joined in a slightly more formal way, shared with NHLI. And my role is to chair the questions and answers. And I'm not going to do any Mentimeter. I've got that because though there is a clock up there, it's telling me it's 20 to 12, and I've no idea whether it's nearly lunchtime or past bedtime, but I don't think I can trust it. So we've got an audience here in person, so you're free to ask questions. We also have, I suspect, an even bigger audience online. I'm only a statistician, but anyway, very roughly the same number of people, but they're putting questions in. We've got Alex who's doing those, and if they come at an even rate, I'll alternate, but obviously I'm happy to take them from wherever comes. So does anybody want to make a start? Do you have one, Alex?
Yeah, I could start off with an online one. Hmm? Could start off with an online one.
Okay. You're put to shame, the people who are here in person.
I don't fully understand this question.
Okay.
How do you deal with the challenge of PII and keeping records anonymous but without losing the value of following individual profiles?
Yeah, so that's an excellent question. So that's about being able to conserve patient anonymity, so using data for research purposes where you're not able to then go back and recognise who individuals are. There are a couple of ways that this can be done. So sometimes people actually consent to be contacted, and you can look at things within the electronic healthcare records, but you have their permission to then be able to go back to something if you find something. Other times, though, particularly with the type of data that we use, we have absolutely no idea who individuals are within the data set, and nor would we have any ability to be able to find out who they are, because the pseudonymization keys sit within a trusted research environment within NHS Digital that we would never have any access to. You know, if you were really desperate and really bored, you could probably figure out from some rare disease who a particular individual was. But, you know, as I repeatedly say when I get asked this question, which is actually a fairly common question to get asked, A, I'm not particularly interested in you as an individual. I'm interested in things at a population level. And B, why would I ruin my career by trying to figure out who you are when I've spent the last 10 years trying to build it up?
Thank you. So, okay, so I saw question down here first and then question up there second, so you're going to keep the colleague with the mic very fit.
Laura, this makes me very nervous.
Don't worry. In keeping with your garbage in, garbage out, and your theme of poor coding massively impacts the accuracy of data and what we can glean from it, have you thought about how we can fix that, and should we take away coding from doctors?
Yeah, so that's a very good question, and actually I think the exact opposite. I think we need to be educating doctors about how to code. So I lead the research skills domain across the lower years of the medical school curriculum, and one of the things that I've now introduced is several sessions around electronic healthcare record and data. And one of the things that we do is we sit down and we look at coding and how things are coded. And what's fascinating is how most of them had absolutely no idea as to the implications that coding has further on down the line. And there are very big programs that look at benchmarking services purely based on what people end up entering. So I think instead of taking it away, it's more about educating people to do it better.
Okay, so do we have another one online? Okay, so we'll go online, then we'll go to the back, then online, and then there's somebody with fellow in the blue shirt. Oh, well, there's two fellows in the blue shirt. We'll go one and then the other. Right, anyway, online.
What do you think about data analytics and data science in terms of revolutionising the future scope of the health industry?
So I think there's enormous potential, but I still think we have to get the fundamentals and the basics right. And a lot of people think that I'm really weird and slightly geeky because I get so obsessed with the coding. But, you know, I've shown you several examples tonight how if you don't get it right, and no amount of AI or machine learning or data analytics is going to make any of that any better. And we've got to get the fundamentals and the basics right. And I think we can. And I think we can absolutely revolutionise how we use healthcare and healthcare data within the UK.
Thank you. So right at the back, well, the lady with the mic.
Thank you very much. So thanks very much, Jenny, for a great talk. I have the privilege of working with Jenny in the education realm. And my question is, how do we inspire the next generation of clinical academics? What do we need to do to support them to get to be standing where you are?
That's a really difficult question, Mary. I think it starts with simply basic education. So when I was putting together some of the teaching, and I asked some of the GPs in School of Public Health to help me put together some of the teaching, they said to me, do you know, when I started as a GP trainee, no one ever explained to me the importance of coding in a particular way, of where I put the codes in the medical records and how that comes out the other side. And so I think when people understand all this a bit more and they understand the implications, they then start to get enthused by it. So I think it really is about educating.
Okay, thank you. So have we got another online one? And then we'll go to one of the two fellas in the blue shirt. I think we'll probably take those two, and then we're going to have to wind up fairly soon. But
do you think electronic healthcare records could help in subdividing diseases into categories that differ in treatment benefit or in differing susceptibility to risk factors? Is the right sort of data going in to do that?
Yeah, so that's an excellent question, actually, and that's really around trying to phenotype or thinking about things in terms of treatable traits. And the answer to that is really yes and no. And I think this is where linkage of data becomes particularly important. A lot of the time when we're using things within routine clinical practice, if I think about COPD and eosinophils as an example, we don't necessarily know why somebody's had a blood test done in primary care. So we don't know that the eosinophils really are an appropriate marker of what's going on with their COPD. But there are lots of cohorts around where people are systematically measuring things. And I think there's real importance in being able to link some of these cohorts together with some of the routine data to be able to tackle some of those issues. And then absolutely they can be used for that purpose.
Thank you. So, person with the mic.
Thanks so much, Jenny. Really interesting talk. I work for a patient engagement platform, and we capture a lot of data. So I'd be really curious to hear how the red tape's dropped for you, but also how you see that changing, things like the federated data platform coming in. Is that going to impact what you can do in the future? Is that speeding things up?
Yeah, so those are good questions, actually. So the red tape has really changed in terms of the speed with which we've been able to access data. So a lot of it's been form filling and simple data access. I think there's absolutely a role for federated environments, for trusted research environments to be able to go in and access data. It's interesting because I was at a meeting earlier this week and people were saying, well, trusted research environments are great for research because the data doesn't move, it stays in one place, it's very secure, people just log in and use it. But that doesn't necessarily then easily translate back into policy or what's going on locally within clinical practice. So I think we're going to end up with almost parallel systems to a certain extent. And what would also be nice, though, would be to be able to train up clinically some of these people or to get some of the clinical people locally who are driving policy and using their data to work more closely with analysts to be able to better understand how they use their data.
Okay, thank you. So we'll take one more online and then a fellow who's just in front has now got the mic, and then I think that will be it for the formal part. But Alex.
How could we utilise routinely collected electronic healthcare record data to address the challenges and concerns related to health and social care inequalities?
So I think they're a fantastic way to do that. I'm just writing an entire grant on it, so I might answer that question at a later point in time.
Oh, I was wondering how you're going to keep that one snappy. Right. So, again.
Fantastic stuff, Jenny. Once you've solved the coding problem and you've got your big data sets, what's the future? Is it artificial intelligence or the more traditional brain-powered sort?
I think it's a mixture of both, actually. I don't think you can have one without the other, but I absolutely don't see AI replacing the importance of some of the human decisions that go on with using the data.
Thank you. And I think the number of questions is testament to how good this was, and I know that there are more people want to ask, so that will have to wait to the drinks. But before then, it gives me great pleasure. I've worked with Visha nearly probably 20 years ago, and I'm going to invite you to give the vote of thanks for Jenny, who you've known pretty much almost as long.
Jenny, thank you very much. I'm sure you'll all agree with me, this was the perfect inaugural lecture. It was informative, it showed the trajectory, the work was so highly relevant to healthcare, to improving patients' quality of life. I was very impressed. I was sitting here even taking a few notes. I must just say one thing. I really enjoyed seeing your three cats. So when Jenny told me she was going to get cat number three, it was that lovely striped one. Do you know what I did? I went and got two more because I had three. And I thought, there's no way I will let Jenny catch me up on cats. So I now have five cats and I can send you. Lucy, I must send you some more photos. So, yes, so I'm the person who gave Jenny her first job on the Central Line. We used to do a lot of work on the Central Line, if you remember, between the London Chest and Barts. And we had a great time, actually, at the Royal Free and UCL. And it was really the beginning. With all respect to Jenny's family, we were way ahead of the Americans on COPD research. We very easily got an R01 grant then, if you remember, without actually much effort. It just came. Even Patrick Vallens was surprised. He was then head of medicine. How did you manage to get that? So we had a great time. But there was something else I did at the time, which was I was very interested in publications. I was the editor of the journal Thorax. And do you know, I'm so pleased that you've been appointed as editor of Thorax. You haven't talked about it, but it is a very important role, both in the UK and further afield. I love publications. Not many of us have the chance of being able to edit a journal. And if any of you get the opportunity, do take it up. So since that time, Jenny's moved on to much higher things. I've become a personal friend. I'm actually Lucy's godmother. We meet at regular intervals and have a good old gossip. I'm afraid it was Jenny who told me all about Jimmy Choo's shoes. I'm afraid I'm in Marks and Spencer's today because I couldn't really manage it. So just to finish off, I'd like to thank Jenny again. You know, it was brilliant, actually. I don't need to say anything more. There's so much more to come from Jenny, isn't there? You could just see it in the way she talked today. I'd like to thank Edwin for giving the introduction, for Deborah. Yes, we have worked. We were at Bath together, yes. Good old days, yes. In fact, I think, Deb, you came to my inaugural, we're not sure if Jenny was there. We can't quite work it out. We think not yet, actually. I'd like to thank the team at Imperial for laying this on. I'd like to thank Jenny's family. I know a lot of you. I'm delighted to see you. I'll be catching up. I saw you all outside, but I didn't have the courage actually to go up and say hello. I'd like to thank everyone first online who's joined today. It is really nice. There's a lot of people online supporting Jenny. It just shows how much interest there is in her work, both at Imperial and worldwide. And thank you all for coming, and have a very nice evening. And Jenny, can we once again show Jenny a vote of thanks?
Thank you, Visha. So it just remains for me to, I'm not going to repeat what Visha said, but just to underscore it, that thanks to everybody involved. One final remark, I was very taken with you talking about failure. And I remember when my daughter, some years ago, said, shall I apply to a very prestigious university? I might not get in. I said, well, A, if you don't apply, you won't get in. And she didn't. But I said, if you don't fail from time to time, you're not aiming high enough. And I think, yeah, Jenny has failed, succeeded. I'm sure that some things will fail again. I expect to see you tearing your hair out because it'll be unfair. But I also expect to see you because you're not afraid to try. And so it's fabulous having you around the School of Public Health and acting as a link. My main job is to invite those of you who are here in person to come outside, have a drink, to carry on these conversations, and to thank those online, and just find yourself a cup of tea or whatever you've got in the cupboard, and join us in spirit. And perhaps have one with Jenny when you next see her. But thank you very much indeed, and I'm only finishing 1 minute late, so I'm not doing too badly.
Thank you.